Hi. It's a nice warm room, so we can take naps. I'll try and get early and get a nap in before the party. My name is Mike Anello. This is all about custom content migrations into Drupal 8. So if you're hoping for a broad overview, then that'll be the first half. If you don't want to see an overview and you want to go into some gory details, that'll be the second half. So basically, I'm going to give you an overview of kind of the various ways you can do data migrations, content migrations into Drupal 8. And then I will dismiss most of them with a wave of my hand and tell you the way I think you should be doing it. And that's the one we're going to dive into. And we'll see code, we'll see a live demo, we'll see a migration happen. So we should be in pretty good shape. If you have questions, just ask. Interrupt me. That doesn't bother me at all. All right, so this is me. Drupal Easy is my company. We do training and consulting and quick add. I do a 12-week Drupal career online program, 3 half-days a week. We teach everything from Drupal to Git to developer workflows. So if you are interested in something like that or know someone, let me know. And we have our next class starts in mid-March. But I do about half training, half consulting, project coaching. I'm really big into best practices. So hopefully what I'm going to show you today is just right along those lines of kind of what's the best way to get data into Drupal 8? Like what's the best non-hacky way of doing it? Let's see, I'm Ultimike everywhere. I was a core contributor for migration, so I know a little bit about what we're doing here. So I think that's enough about me. So let's talk about migration basics 101, just so we kind of level set everybody. There's a source, and in this picture it looks like a database, but it doesn't have to be a database. It can be a CSV file. It can be a pile of XML files. It can be a database. It can be pretty much anything that talks PDL. So Postgres, MSSQL, Maria, MySQL. And if there's a source that you have that isn't yet supported, you can write a new source plugin. And basically, you just have to describe how to query your source. So within Drupal core, there's a source plugin to talk to databases. In contrib, there's a source plugin to talk to pull in CSV files. So most of the major, the big ones are already covered. But the migrate stuff in Drupal 8 is all very object-oriented. So if there's a source that you have that hasn't been accounted for yet, you can write a source plugin and talk to that source. So it's an extremely flexible system. So we have the source, then we have the destination, which for our purposes is going to be a Drupal 8 site. And actually specifying the destination is probably the easiest part of a migration. In the example we see, we're going to create nodes. And in our migration configuration, it's basically two lines. Where we say destination is entity node. So that's what we want to create. The middle part is where things get really interesting, and that's where we have to do our jobs. We call it the pipeline. But it's a pipeline of data from the source to the destination. So we have to get the data, first of all, and then we have to map the data. So saying this field in the source is going to eventually end up in this field in the destination. So we have to map the data. And sometimes it's just that simple. There's no manipulation of that data in the pipeline. We get it, we set it, and we're done. But it's a pipeline, and we have these things called process plugins, which, is just a nice way of saying massaging the data, tweaking the data on its way from source to destination. And so this pipeline supports multiple process plugins. So you can get the data, you can apply one thing to it, maybe you're getting a comma delimited string. So you can apply what's called an explode plugin. Anyone who knows PHP knows what explode does. It takes a comma, takes a string that's separated by delimiter and turns it into an array of items. And then maybe you want to pass that to a static map plugin that maps the values to new values. So you can kind of build up the pipeline depending on your source data and what that needs to be on the destination. This diagram is basically how the Drupal 8 migration system works. We have source plugins, we have destination plugins, we have get plugins, we have a way to map, which is a configuration file, which is where the most of our work is going to be, and we have these process plugins. And if you need to massage the data in a way that one of the existing process plugins doesn't already cover, you can write a new process plugin. Not that bad. It's object-oriented. You basically extend an existing class. I've actually been experimenting with another way of doing it. One of the existing process plugins is called a callable. And basically, it's a way for you to call some other PHP function. It's kind of like a generic wrapper around a PHP function as part of your process pipeline. So the system's extremely flexible. And I find the hurdle for most people in learning it is it's that first step. It's like, how do I do a simple migration? Because once you see a simple migration, hopefully in what's about 4 minutes, you can leave here saying, okay, well, that wasn't that bad. I can do that. And then pretty much everything else after that is just kind of extending what I'm going to show you, just adding complexity the whole way. But the kind of the first one you have to do, especially with D8, with D7, how many people use Migrate and D7? Okay, so I mean, there's a bunch of PHP involved when you're writing a custom migration. If you're lucky, if your data doesn't have to be massaged all that much, Drupal 8 migration, custom Drupal 8 migration is no PHP. The one I'm going to show you today, no PHP. It's a custom module with no PHP. That's pretty freaking awesome, right? It's basically a custom module with some YAML files. So YAML's nice. There's no, there's no dollar signs or anything in there. So that's kind of the big picture of where we're going. So we'll see this diagram a bunch. Most migrations, you have to do multiple pipelines. Nodes, users, vocabularies. If we're just talking about content and data, you could have 4 or 5, depending on how many things you need to actually move over. And one migration might be dependent on another, just like in D7. Right? If you want to migrate nodes and each node has an author, you have to migrate the authors first and then migrate your nodes. Because you have dependency issues there. You could end up with having a lot of different migrations. The built-in D6 or D7 update path to Drupal 8, which is kind of like the migration system hidden behind a pretty wall where you enter some database information and hit a button, attempts to migrate everything, configuration and content all at once. Now there are a bunch of migrations. For a simple Drupal 6 site that doesn't use much more than core modules and CCK, you could easily have 60 or more migrations, depending on the number of content types and vocabularies and things like that, number of fields. So these get complicated really fast. What we're going to talk about mainly today is content, not configuration. Because for the vast majority of people I talk to and clients I have, I don't recommend you using the basic upgrade path. I recommend you do what most of you have probably already heard of, a migrate and rebuild. Right? Because if you have a Drupal 6 site that you need to get to Drupal 8, chances are there's a couple things in that Drupal 6 site that are either obsolete, or the information architecture is just broken or annoying. And it was probably built 6, 7, 8 years ago, maybe not that long, 6, 5, 6 years ago. And just organizations and their data needs change, so it needs to evolve. So chances are you don't want to turn your Drupal 6 site into Drupal 8 site and keep all the stuff you don't like about it. You want to kind of have a chance to re-architect it. Get your new information architecture in there, and then take your existing D6 data and map it to your new stuff. That's what the vast majority of clients that I see actually want. So the base migration, the base upgrade path, doesn't really let you do that, because it's going to take your content types in D6 as they are, put them in D8, all of their warts included. So what we're going to focus on is just content migrations. So keep this in mind. Keep this pipeline in mind as we go. So migration Drupal style, I'm talking ahead already of my slides, but content plus configuration. So it's possible, it's not just possible, it happens, where you can migrate configuration just as easily as you migrate content, using all the same tools, the same pipeline. You know, fields have data associated with them. You know, what widget are they using? What formatter are they using? What type of data is it? All that stuff is stored in the database, and you can migrate that out of D6 and into D8. Again, we're going to focus on content, because I think that's where, you know, probably 90% of the migrations that I see actually care about is the content. So when you go, when you think about going to migrate into Drupal 8, I kind of look at it as there's four main ways that you can go. And probably more than four, but you know, the four that I see 99% of the time I'm going to cover here. I gave them fun names. House of Pain, Whole Enchilada, Migration by Subtraction, and Migration Satisfaction. Guess which one we're going to do a demo on. So let's talk about House of Pain. That's manually migrating content. And a lot of times when I suggest this to a client, they're like, oh, no, we don't want to do that. But I will suggest that if we're just talking about dozens of nodes, or maybe even somewhere close to 100 pieces of content need to be migrated, it actually could be more efficient from a time and cost perspective to just manually move that stuff. So if you've got a small Drupal 6 or Drupal 7 brochure type site, there's no point in using migration, but by the time it takes an experienced developer to build that migration, test it, and run it, you could probably pay someone at a lower rate to migrate manually. So, pros of that, during that manual migration, you can kind of use that as an opportunity to do a content audit of what you have and update your content along the way. So that tends to be, something that interests people. The cons are it's manual. It could be error prone, right? You can make mistakes. It should be not much more than copy paste, but it's a manual process, so things can go wrong, things can be missed. The whole enchilada is the core upgrade path. And that is the one where you basically go to a page on Drupal.org, on your Drupal site, and you say, let me go back. You fire up a fresh Drupal 8 site, you enable the right migrate modules, and that provides an update that PHP page where you enter in your Drupal 6 or Drupal 7 database credentials, a path so that the Drupal 8 site can find your files directory on your legacy site, and you hit a button. And the core migrate will basically suck in everything, content and configuration. I'm basically trying to reproduce your Drupal 6 site in Drupal 8. It's easy. It's a UI. The cons are you're not going to get everything. Chances are you're not going to get everything. The only stuff you're going to get is, out of the box, you're going to get anything that's supported by Drupal Core, which I use a lot more Drupal 6 and Drupal 7 sites. So we support CCK, dates, things that weren't necessarily core in Drupal 6, but are core in Drupal 8. But if you are using a bunch of other modules in Drupal 6, and those modules either don't exist in Drupal 8, or their Drupal 8 counterparts do not have migration classes in them, you're not going to get any data from those modules. So there's going to be stuff that literally falls, well, maybe not literally, but figuratively falls through the cracks that you're not going to get. The other downside to this is, like I mentioned earlier, you're going to be stuck with whatever the architecture was in Drupal 6, you're going to be stuck with it in Drupal 8. You can always go back and refactor it in Drupal 8 afterwards, but if you have a field that you want to change in some way, there's no super straightforward way to move data from one field to another in Drupal 8. You've got to do some database manipulation or some custom code there. So again, if it's a real simple Drupal 6 site and you just want to get it on Drupal 8 and be done with it and you're fine with it, then this is probably the way to go. But I haven't found too many clients that are interested in doing something like that. Migration by subtraction. This one has some traction. That's my pun for the day. Subtraction. You get it? It's a modified Drupal Core upgrade. So think of it this way. It allows you to basically set up like you're going to do the full upgrade. It doesn't simulate it, but it sets up all of the kind of the configuration for doing a full upgrade. But it doesn't actually run the upgrade at that point. It gives you the opportunity to go into those configuration files and get rid of some or change some or kind of tweak them and then run them all. So I call it migration by subtraction because what happens is a lot of times a lot of people will just remove migrations from that. Like, oh, we don't want to move this vocabulary, so we're just going to get rid of that pipeline right there. Or, oh, we don't want to, we don't need to worry about, this whole content type and all these fields, so we're just going to remove all those configuration files. And that's good. You really have to know what you're doing, though, when you do that. Because that goes back to all those dependencies, right? Because if you try to move, like, a content type and you remove a field, then that content type migration might not run because it depends on that field. And that's a simple example, but things like text formats, things like image styles, things that are specified by a formatter, those are dependencies. And those can stop you dead in your tracks. So getting rid of migrations could kind of be like playing whack-a-mole. It's like, oh, I got rid of those. Oh, my migration doesn't run. Let me try adding this one back in. Oh, now this one doesn't run. Let me add this one back in. But then I want to take this one out. So it becomes a lot of trial and error from what I found. It does allow, though, for limited customization. An example of customization, let's say you have a field, your D6 content type, that you want to migrate to a different field in D8. Maybe it's the same type of field, but it's a different name. That type of customization is easy because you can open up the config file and just type in the right field name in D8 you want to map it to. That stuff's very easy with this. I just find that it's the amount of time to get this working the way you want could probably be better spent just doing it, what I call migration satisfaction. Which is really, if you think about it, it's probably the way you should be doing it. It's the manual, or it's the custom way. It's building a custom migration because that gets you exactly what you want. You can define that I want this over there and I want it to look like that. You don't want to have to bring over all these things. I just want to bring over all these things and I want to massage them this way. So you, rather than migration by subtraction, where you start with all of these migrations and you're subtracting stuff from it and hoping it works. Custom migrations, you start with nothing and you just build up the migrations that you want. I've had by far the most luck with this. It allows you to get what you need, refactor it however you want, and end up with a D8 result that, if you want, has no resemblance at all to your D6 site with your, other than your content is there in its newly refactored state, which allows you to have a D8 site and take full advantage of all the great things in D8. The cons are, we have to do some work, right? If you got to learn stuff that, if you're going to use a migration system, you should probably know how to do it anyway. So learn this, it'll make you more employable, I'll tell you that right now, because there's a lot of work out there for it. Okay, so those are our four. So let me now, whisk away the first three. House of Pain, I still recommend that every now and then. Like I said, if it's a small site, not a whole lot of content, it's probably worth it just to do it manually. Whole Enchilada, I haven't done for an actual client. I did it as a demo for a client because they wanted to see what their D6 site would look like in D8. I'm like, all right. And they saw it and they were horrified by we still have that problem? You're getting the exact same thing. Migration by subtraction, I started down that road with the client because I thought it would be easier, and I quickly got frustrated kind of just ripped the band-aid off and started afresh with migration satisfaction. Okay, I talked way ahead of my slides. Let's see. I'll get back away slowly. Okay, so the whole enchilada. Yeah, so this is basically a little more details on how you go through each one. This is the full upgrade path. You start with an empty, I gotta update my slide, 8.2 site. So the nice thing about the new upgrade path, which is different than previous major versions of Drupal, previous major versions of Drupal were what's called an upgrade in place, where you take your Drupal 6 database, you point your Drupal 7 code base at it, you run the upgrade path, and the upgrade path, you know, modified that database, changed the structure, moved things around it as it needed. And then at the end of it, that Drupal 6 database was now a Drupal 7 database. The new upgrade path, basically you spin up a brand new fresh Drupal 8 site that has its own Drupal 8 database, and you just point to the Drupal 6 database. And the Drupal 8 migration stuff just reads from that database and pulls it into the Drupal 8 database. So it leaves the Drupal 6 database untouched. What that allows you to do is you could, you know, theoretically you can take your new Drupal 8 site and point to your production server. You know, point to a copy, you know, maybe a test or, you know, something like that, and just read everything in that way. So that is one big advantage of the migrate stuff in D8. But yeah, how do you do it? You enable some modules, go to /upgrade, enter source site information. This is what it looks like. You know, just as easy as you think. Pick your type of database, enter your database credentials, point to where your source files are. You know, maybe you've got a copy of the production files directory under local. Maybe you don't. Maybe you just point directly at your production site and pull them directly from production, which you can do. Hit that little button, you know, click, and it'll show you what's going to happen. And hit another button, and you'll see the little progress bar. Stuff will happen. Come back, and you've got a Drupal 8 site. Clients don't like making a Drupal 8, because I feel like it's a Drupal 6 site masquerading as a Drupal 8 site at that point. Yes, okay, so, yeah, and that will run basically everything. That will run all of the migrations. And these migrations, it's kind of interesting, all of these migrations, a lot of them are generated dynamically, right? Because if you have 14 content types, you've got to have 14 content type migrations. If those 14 content types and 57 fields between them, you've got 57, actually you have, 57 times 3, right, 171, is that right? 171 migrations, right, because you've got, it might even be 57 times 4, I'd have to go back and look, but I think you're going to have a field base, migration, field instance, field formatter, field widget, so all of those things have their own migrations, so the number of migrations that run, you know, gets up there fast. addition by subtraction, how does this one work? Again, you start with an empty Drupal 8.2 site. You can start with 8.1 if you want, but I'd probably recommend 8.2. You got to enable core, some core modules, as well as the contrib module, Migrate Plus. Why do you need Migrate Plus? Because it's got a magic Drush command. Migrate, upgrade, --, config only. So that's the one I told you that basically, when you run that Drush command, Migrate module will look at your Drupal 6 site and say, okay, you've got 14 content types, 57 fields, 13 vocabularies, blah, blah, blah. I will generate all the migrations, but I won't run them. And when I say generate those migrations, what it's doing is generating YAML files. One YAML file per migration. And we're going to look at a YAML file in a minute. So it will generate all of those YAML files for you, and then it'll stop. And then at that point, you can go in and look at your giant pile of YAML files and start tweaking. You can remove the ones you don't want. You can go in and, you know, change some file names or change some mappings or, you know, set some default values, whatever you want to do. And then once you have, and you basically use your modified YAML files as the basis for your custom migration at that point. And that's really where the trial by error starts. I find it's just crazy to, it's, I don't know, it's not dangerous, but it's, we'll say crazy frustrating, because you want to remove migrations because you don't want to, you know, you want to, let's say you want to rebuild your information architecture, but you want to use, you know, addition by subtraction. The problem with that is, so you go to your Drupal 8 site, you build out your new content types, your new fields and everything, and then you have to pull out all of your configuration migrations that involve content types and fields, but then you still want to map all of your content. So there's actually a lot of work there to get everything right and go through all of your configuration files and make sure you're deleting all the right ones and keeping the right ones. And I just find it's for sites that have any level of complexity, it's extremely frustrating. And I have a pretty high bar. I have two teenagers, so I get pretty frustrated sometimes. So. Simple sites just works. It's actually an interesting exercise to go through just to see all of those configuration files you generated and see what they look like, but I'm not a big fan of this one. And then after you tweak them, you export them, package them up in a custom module, very similar to the one I'm about to show you. We're going to modify configurations, okay. Run the migration, very good. So I think of that looking something like this. That's all of those migrations, some of them you took out, and the ones in red are things you tweaked. And you hope that you took out the ones that you can and left the ones you need and stuff like that, but it's a little bit spotty and patchy. Migration satisfaction, start as an empty site. You're going to need core or core modules, and this is specifically for a D6 to D8 site. If you're doing like a migrate data in a CSV file into your D8 site, you're not obviously going to need the migrate Drupal core module. The migrate Drupal core module, I'll take a second here and just explain. There's two main modules in Drupal core, the migrate module and migrate Drupal. The migrate module is like the brain. Okay, that provides all the base classes that everything else kind of grows out of. The migrate Drupal module, what that really contains is source plugins for Drupal 6 and Drupal 7. So the way I explain that to people is the migrate Drupal module knows how to get a content type out of a Drupal 6 database. The Drupal 6 and the migrate Drupal module knows how to get the configuration values for a field formatter out of a Drupal 6. It knows the right query to run against a Drupal 6 database to get the data. And then there's also a couple of contrib modules. Migrate tools, which contains, those of you who use the Drupal 7 migrate module, if you use Drush, remember Drush MI for migrate import, Drush MS for migrate status, Drush MR for migrate rollback. Migrate tools provides basically those Drush commands. Those Drush commands are not in core, they're in migrate tools. And migrate plus basically provides classes that are extended from migrate. And when you write a custom migration, you basically extend migrate plus classes. And it sounds complicated when I say it out loud, but it's not that complicated when you see it. So if you're going to do a custom migration, you realize the minimum you need migrate tools, migrate plus, and migrate. So you build your Drupal 8 site. That's the best part, right? Because you know you have in Drupal 6 or Drupal 7, but you can build, you're not tied to it anymore. You build up the content types you want. You build up the information architecture that you want. You get it signed off by your client. You enter in some sample data. You can go through that whole process and make it Drupal 80, and just feel good about it. Once you get your information architecture set, then you get a spreadsheet out, you get a big piece of paper, and you sit down with your client and say, okay, well, here's your content in Drupal 6. Where's this vocabulary going in Drupal 8? All right, it's going to this vocabulary over here. Now, how do the fields match up? Oh, we can drop that field? Great. Oh, this field needs to be transmogrified into something else? Fantastic. So, at this point, you do your mapping. And those of you, again, who've used T7 Migrate know what that mapping's all about. Then you build your custom migrations. Harmless little bullet point there. How hard can that be? We'll see it in a minute. Then you run your custom migrations, and then... I thought I had another bullet there. Then you do a happy dance. But the way that looks is everything's custom. You've built your migrations, you've written them, and it sounds scary still, but believe me, when I show you, I'm hoping you're not going to be nearly as scared, because it's I don't want to say it's easy, but getting over that first hurdle feels really good. It's like, oh, hopefully light bulbs will come on and you'll feel good about it. So let's go danger, right? So here we go. So I'm actually going to use, as our source, DrupalEasy.com was on Drupal 6 up till about a year and a half ago. And I skipped Drupal 7 and I went right to Drupal 8. So our source is going to be my DrupalEasy 6 site, DrupalEasy.com on Drupal 6. So it's a real source site, not some made-up demo site. It's real data. And the destination is going to be, you know, the copy of Drupal 8.2 that I just downloaded this morning. So what's the goal here? We're going to move one of our content types, or one of our, you know, data from one of our content types in Drupal 6 into Drupal 8. And we're going to tweak some things along the way. We're going to change the name of the field. We're actually going to change the name of the content type, the machine name of the content type. And what's the third? There's a third thing. Oh, in Drupal 6, we used a markdown filter as part of a text format. And so we're going to have markdown filter for Drupal 8 installed and make sure we map that field format, the text format across. Oh, and I have the list right here. So those are the three things we're going to do, our three little tweaks. So the first thing we have to do is build the Drupal 8 site and configure it. I've already done that, so that's kind of the cooking show portion of the demo. I'll show it to you in a second. We're going to create the custom migration. Okay, I've already done that, but we are going to go through it line by line. We're going to see every file of that custom migration, and then I'm going to run the migration. It's not enabled yet. The only thing that's enabled right now are the modules I just told you about. So we're going to enable my custom migration. We're going to run it with Drush. We're going to roll back. We're going to import. So we're going to kind of see it in action. Okay, so what have I done? Just so there's nothing up my sleeves, I'll show you tell you exactly what I did. Standard install profile, installed some contrib modules, admin toolbar, markdown, I needed the libraries module for markdown as a dependency, migrate tools, and migrate plus. I added a new text format. I called it markdown. I used the markdown text filter as part of it. I created a new content type called audio. I added a link field to it, so I'm going to show all that to you in a minute. And keep in mind, this is what I'm going to show you, but in configuration. We have a source, which is our DrupalEasy 6 site. We have a destination, which is our Drupal 8.2 site. We're going to get some stuff. We're going to massage some stuff. We're going to save some stuff. All of the code I'm about to show you is available. I'll put this back up later, but you can get all the code I'm about to show you. Even better, though, I've actually written a blog post all about what I'm about to show you as well. If you're not off in this terribly warm room in the next 35 or whenever we end, what time do we end here? Like 20, the next 25 minutes? Oh, there's a glare. I can't see. Oh, there it is. I don't see the big hand. If you're not off, you can read all about what I'm about to show you. Go step by step. And just remind me at the end of this, I'll put these URLs back up if you want to see it. Okay, so here is the source site. It's local. I'm using Acquainted Dev Desktop, so I'm trying to keep this as simple as possible. So I'm not using any crazy, AMP setup. It's just, it's a local copy of the old site. Here is my brand new D8 site. And I'll show you the configuration that I did real quick. I'll just walk through. I have added a new text format called Markdown. Not a whole lot to it. There's the markdown filter that I enabled. Put stuff in the right order. So that's not a whole lot to it. And I added a podcast content type. Has a name. That's exciting. And I kept the body field and I just added a new field of type link called audio URLs. And I don't think there's really anything special about it. I think I disabled the link text. So, pretty simple. So what's the goal is to, I'm not logged in here, but here's a podcast right here, migrate content like this into here and have it appear, like it appears here. Now all this content, if I were to edit this is all kind of markdown. Everybody familiar with markdown, what that is? Okay, so it's in markdown format. And I want to make sure that my link, where is it? Do I even have it here somewhere? Oh, I do have it, but it's, well, the audio link, you know, is not showing up here because on the old site it was a flash widget and I have flash turned off. So the URL would display as a flash widget. So I want to have that link show up as a link here. All right, everybody clear on kind of where we're going with this? All right, so those of you who just want the overview can nod off now. Those of you who want the gory details, time to wake up, because that's where we're going. Okay. Okay. Questions? Sure. I'll take a second, take a breath. Okay. So, what do we got? Here is our site down here. Drupal Migrate. There's modules directory. You know, contrib has all the stuff I mentioned. A couple things I didn't mention but aren't enabled. Custom directory has a new module. DE6 Migrate. Okay? So again, this is not enabled yet. So here's the module. This is kind of what it's what's included in it. It has a info file. All modules have to have an info file. There are no dot module file. No PHP in this module whatsoever. The info file is pretty boring, pretty basic stuff. A name, type, description, core, a package. And for this module to be successful, we need Migrate Drupal and Migrate Plus to run. So nothing, you know, nothing remotely migrating in here other than a couple of dependencies. The only other thing in the module is a couple of configuration files. They're in a couple of directories, config/install. So this is important. This is one of those things you want to, if you're actually serious about doing this is one of the parts you really need to pay attention to. Those of you who know a little bit about Drupal 8 development, or custom module development, hopefully you've learned that configurations that live in config/install are brought into the active configuration, which is the database, only when the module is first enabled. Okay, so when I enable this module, the configuration that lives in these two YAML files will be brought into the active configuration. And the information in those two YAML files is our migration, and basically it's our pipeline. So why is that important? That's important because while you're developing your migration, you might find the first time through, oops, I made a mistake. And I need to go back into this YAML file and change something and rerun the migration. And you'll do your rollback, you know, you'll make your change, you hit Command S, you do your rollback, you do your import, and nothing changes. The reason nothing changes is because Drupal's not going to see your change. Because that module's already enabled. The configuration is already in the database. So you can change your file all you want. And the active configuration is not going to change. So that's kind of a pain in the butt. That's kind of, you know, that kind of sucks, actually. So how do you get around it? Well, you could disable the module and re-enable it. And with the migration system, there's kind of another sucky thing about it. When you disable a custom migration, it doesn't actually remove the old configuration for some crazy reason. You should ask one of the people who contribute. That's another joke, because it's me. So here's the, and this is in the blog post, it's at the very end. It's like a gotcha. There is a drush command that when you're developing migrations, you need to get comfortable with. Anybody know what it's going to be? Anybody who works with custom modules, or even the configuration system, you might know this. Drush config edit. So what you have to do is, and I found this the most efficient way to go, is you do drush config edit, basically the name of the configuration, which is basically the name of the file minus the YAML stuff. And what drush, so you do drush config edit, and then you would say, migrate plus migration dot DE6 underscore audio. And that will open up that configuration in your command line test editor. You make your changes, you quit it, and that immediately, boom, goes into active configuration. So if you want to tweak your active configuration, you can't do it by tweaking a file. Well, you can, but then you have to jump through some more hurdles in order to get that into active configuration. I found, for me, the most efficient way of doing it is using Drush config edit. So it's a big gotcha. It'll, you know, everyone who's written a custom migration, you know, for the first time gets bitten by it. So don't be one of those people. Those people are sad for about an hour and a half. And then they become really happy when they figure it out. So I'm trying to help you avoid an hour and a half of sadness. That should be the, like, the name of the talk, I think. That's a good idea. So okay.
How do you generate the YAML file from like D7, like all those mapping?
Hi, where do you start? Oh man, I should pay you to do my segues for me. I'm gonna tell you in a second, okay? It's one of those things that I'm gonna get right there in a second. So let's not even look at this one, because this one kind of is long. So config install, and I always use minimum two configuration files, one for what's called a migration group, and then one for the actual migration. So think of it, so here's what a migration group is. You want to migrate a bunch of stuff from D6 to D8, you know, some content types, some vocabularies, users, whatever. What are all of those migrations gonna have in common? What's the one thing, and everyone's gonna know the answer when I say it, but can anyone guess what I'm about to say here? The source database, right? All of those migrations are pulling their data from the same database. It would kind of suck if you had to write, you know, 15 of these, and all 15 have basically the same five lines that describe the source database. So can't we just share that data in one place? Can't we put that data in once and then have all of our migrations refer to it? Sure, it's called the migration group. So what we do is we have a little YAML file called migration group. We give it a unique identifier. In this case, I think it's DE6, right? And a label, so it's like a bucket for all of our migrations, right? We call it Drupal 6, or Drupal Easy 6 content. In this case, I made the description specific to podcast posts because that's all that's in the bucket right now. The source type, it's a Drupal 6 site. And then the shared configuration. So basically, anything in shared configuration is available to every migration that says, I'm in the DE6 group. So it's just a place to put common information that's going to be shared among all your migrations. It's pretty straightforward. And I don't think I've ever had a migration group configuration file that's anything more than this. You can stick more stuff in there if you want. I guess the other thing that you can see in there a lot, but for some reason I've just never needed to do it, is a path to a files directory. If you need to refer to that path in multiple migrations, you can put that in here as well. I've just never needed to do that for some reason. Okay, so let's get to the main event. Here's our migration for content type. Now, don't even read it yet. Don't look at any of the words. Just, I mean, there's what, 43 lines to it. Do I start with a blank file? I'm gonna ask you a question now, right? Do I start with a blank file and just start typing? Well, you could, but again, that would suck. I'm trying to make it so things don't suck. So what's your starting point? Well, we know we want to move nodes. We know we need to write a migration to move nodes of a particular type. So where do we start? Well, here's the cool thing. Drupal 8 core gives you all of your starting points if you know where to look, right? Let's say you want to move users. Well, the way these migrations work is modules are responsible for their own migration classes. So you don't go look in the migrate module, you go look in the user module. So if we go into core, modules, user, migration templates. Here's all of the various migration templates. Now these are not actual migration configuration files. This is kind of the starting point. This is what the migrate module uses when it generates configuration files. And guess what? This is what we're going to use when we generate custom migration files. So if you need to do a user migration from Drupal 6, that's your starting point. Copy this file, put it into your custom module, name it migrate plus, you know, underscore, whatever, user migration, whatever it has to be. well. There we go. Migrate plus dot migration dot the machine name of your migration, so whatever you want to call it. So this guy right here would become, you know, and this is, you know, that's all the stuff in it, so it's, you know, it has a lot of the same stuff, but this is your starting point. And then you just make tweaks to this. Does that answer your question? Yeah, okay, very good. So look at any module in core. Let's go to where's node begins with N. There we go. Node, yeah, there's a bunch of migration templates. Field. Bunch of, yeah, so this is why I said there's a lot of fields, because there are formatter settings, instance widget settings, field instance, field, formatter settings, LSD7. So there, yeah, for each field that you want to migrate, you're going to have four migrations. So if you have 50 fields on a D6 site, that's 200 migrations.
Can or should those be consolidated?
Into a single one? No, because they're actually querying different parts of the database and being mapped to different parts, to different entities. And in D8, they're being mapped to different config entities. So they can't be consolidated. It's the, you know, it's the, that's the goodness of Drupal 8 biting us in the rear view mirror. So, all right, so you would start with that. So that's exactly what I did for this. So let's break this up into sections, and this becomes extremely approachable when we break it up into sections. First section, I think of this as the metadata. Yes?
Which migration template do you use for this one?
Node, just straight on Node. So just metadata. So you have to give it a unique identifier, so DE6 audio. A label, so that's just friendly. We can call it whatever we want. Migration tabs, it's just tagging it as a Drupal 6 migration. The deriver, you know, where does this migration derive from? You don't have to worry about this, because this is in that node.yml I just showed you. This just gets copied over. And then line 6 is kind of the important one. That's what identifies this migration as part of our group. So by having the migration group key in there, that's what gives this migration access to our source database. That clear? That's an important little point. Okay, so that's our basic information. If we remember our image, we need a source and a destination. We need to define where's the data coming from, where's it going. All right, well, here we go. Here's our source. We're getting source from a D6 node plugin. That D6 node plugin, that's part of the Migrate Drupal module, that's part of core. That's a plugin like any other Drupal 8 plugin. What does that plugin know how to do? That plugin knows how to call up a Drupal 6 site and get nodes. That's what that plugin knows how to do. So we're basically saying, okay, Drupal 6 node plugin, go get me all the nodes of type audio. And that plugin basically returns, you know, a table or, you know, an array, I'm not sure what it is. But it returns all the audio nodes from a Drupal 6 database. That's its job. Its only job is to effectively query a Drupal 6 database and return nodes of the type that we say. And there's plugins for D6 user, D6 vocabulary, D6 term, you know, D6 field settings. Our destination, here are those two lines I was telling you about. All this is saying is Drupal 8, I'm going to give you some stuff, create a node out of it. Now, the stuff I'm going to give you includes the title, the type, the author, the created date. I'm going to give you everything you need. Take this data and create a node. That's it. Okay, so that kind of defines your two endpoints, our source and destination. Node dependencies here. If we wanted to, like if we were going to migrate users first, so we can have authors match up, a dependency might be our custom user migration. And that all that basically is going to do is force us to run the user migration before this one can run. Okay, so we kind of got the bookends done. So now let's take care of all the stuff in the middle, and that's our process section. That's our pipeline. There's all those little lines in between the source and the destination. So let's look at some simple ones. Here's a simple one. The format of our process is on the left is the destination field name, on the right is the source. So what is this doing? This is basically taking the thing called title on the source and mapping it to the thing called title on the destination. It's pretty easy. You know, these that don't need to be massaged and subtract, take the data there, stick the data there, we're good. You know, there's a bunch of them like that. You know, we can take status, create a change, whether or not it's promoted, whether or not it's sticky, and just map those directly to Drupal 8. A few more down here. Revision information. You can map that directly. Fields that have multiple parts. A little bit trickier, not too tricky, right? So here's the body field. So bodies are going to have text format, and bodies are going to have the content. So body value on the destination side is the body from Drupal 6. So we're going to map the body from Drupal 6 to this thing, body value in Drupal 8. And then for body format, we're basically going to force the format of all body fields for all audio or all podcast nodes to use the markdown of text format by default. So we're using a process plugin there. So for body format, we're using a process plugin, which are these awesome little black boxes of code that just do very specific things. This one, all this one does is set a default value. So we're basically saying, it would be nice if we could do something like body slash format colon, and then in quotes put markdown. You know, kind of stick a static value in there, but we can't do that with migration in DA. We kind of have to use this default value plugin, which basically says, you know, take the value in the default value parameter, which is markdown, and stick that into the body format field.
Hey Mike, real quick,
about
fields that allow for multiple values?
Yeah. Again, very good. Let's see, do I have one here, or? The audio URLs is kind of like that. Multi-value fields. I'm sorry, you passed. This would be an array. If Drupal 6 provides it as an array, it's still a one-to-one mapping. It's very simple. A great example of what you're asking is I just did a custom migration from a CSV file into a content type. And one of the fields was like a vocabulary field. And the terms were comma separated. So that was a string. But I needed to get that string into Drupal 8 as an array of values, right? Because that's what the vocabulary, that's what a term field or an entity reference field needs for multiple values. So I needed to use exactly that explode plugin that takes that string, explodes it to an array, and then I pass that array in. All right, so some fields have like their own custom process plugins. So on my Drupal 6 site, the URL field was, who remembers that? The EMF module, embedded media field module in Drupal 6? So the name of the field on Drupal 6 was field embed. And I used this plugin that is part of core called D6 CCK link that knows how to massage data from Drupal 6 CCK link fields and prepare them and put them in the right format that Drupal 8 will accept. So in this case, the format or the process plugin, the little black box is there for us because it's part of core. So that one's kind of nice as well. So all I do is basically point the old field embed, to the new field audio URLs, and just let the plugin handle the data massage there. Here's another default value one. I didn't care about the authors for our podcast nodes, so I set them all to UID1. Doesn't matter, we don't display it, so I don't want to spend the time doing it. Here's another simple one, language code. I just set them all to undefined. It's a single language site, so it wasn't a big deal. And then here's another little tweak I did. In the D6 site, the audio type was, the content type was audio. I wanted to call it podcast in Drupal 8. So I basically ignored what was coming in, and I set it to podcast using a default value. So you're going to get a bunch of these things, you know, when you copy over your node.yaml from core. And you're basically just going to have to, you know, if you want to set default values, you're going to have to tweak this. If you, you know, have some custom fields, and, well, custom fields that are unique to your site, you just have to add them like this. Things like GeoField. You know, GeoField is a nice module for Drupal 8 because that has a process plugin that knows how to take data. It actually knows how to take two fields, a latitude field and a longitude field, and combine them and put them in a GeoField in Drupal 8. So contrib modules are starting to provide these migration classes to help migrations go smoother. So any questions on this? Because we're basically done. I'm gonna run the migration, it's gonna work, we're gonna be happy, and we're not gonna say. Yeah.
I think you already covered it, but I just want to be sure.
I'll say it again.
So when you're doing this mapping, it's kind of a key thing to know is how to find the right plugin, right? For your particular input field. Can you talk a little bit again about how you identify the right plugin?
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of them are pretty straightforward. Like if you, I mean, obviously, some of these don't need a plugin. If you're going text to text, you're not gonna need a plugin. You know, on the source, this is a link field. So if we try to, and the link field in a Drupal 6 site, the information architecture of a Drupal 6 link field, it does not look like the information architecture of a Drupal 8 link field. So, you know, trial and error, what I try first, and probably what most people would try, is just, you know, ignore all this stuff and just try to map it directly. You know, just have this there. And it's going to fail. And you're going to get some error and something about the array key missing or something that Drupal 8 doesn't know what to do with the data you're handing it. So there's luckily, there's documentation on Drupal.org that shows all of the process plugins. So if I can find it real quick, because now that I look at the time, I'm getting close to Drupal 8. Migrate process. You can see I've got it. I was just reviewing the documentation patches a few minutes ago. Process plugin migration. So are they all here? Yeah, there's a GeoField one. Yeah. So the D6 CCK link plugin is not documented here. Actually, this documentation is going. I don't see it's going away. It's moving to API.drupal.org. So rather than it being kind of manually curated, it's going to be in the code and appear on api.drupal.org. That's kind of what we're in the process of. It'll be a lot easier to find there because it doesn't exist here. The way I believe I found it, that's my calendar, we don't need to see that, is if we go into, that is actually going to be a, let me make this bigger so we can see, a Migrate Drupal process plugins, migrate, CCK field. Oh no, let's see. Where's that one gonna be? Maybe it's in the link. That would actually make more sense now that I'm talking out loud. Migrate, process, D6, there it is. So it's buried. And if we looked at this, you would see that its annotation basically makes this the ID. Okay. So it's not, I'll be honest with you, it's not super obvious, some of them, but they're there. Yeah, okay, so just keep our eye on the big picture here, right? Source, destination, pipeline. Okay, and where you're gonna end up spending your most amount of time is, what's your name, your first name? Ian?
Yeah.
Just like Ian says, you're gonna have a field that is gonna make you a little bit nutty, like how do you get the data cleanly from there to there. My first stop in the past, if I didn't know the process plugin off the top of my head, is the documentation page of this, all the process plugins. If that didn't show it, then I would start searching. If I knew it was like a entity reference field, I would go into core and look, you know, that I'm not an entity reference module, no. But I would start looking for plugins involving entity references. Yeah.
So if you don't have a kind of like a plugin out of the box. You have to write those four files per field that you mentioned earlier?
No. Those files are really, you know, those four file migrations are only if you want to migrate the field definition from 6 to 7. It has nothing to do with migrating the field content. Okay. It's the field definition. Okay, so let's run this thing. All right, so first thing we got to do, we got to do --en-yde6migrate. So let's enable the module, because I've tried to run this migration without enabling the module, and it doesn't work nearly as well. Okay, so who remembers drush-ms? Is this big enough? So this is, here, I'll write the whole thing out. Migrate status, or drush-ms. This shows you your migrations that you have. So when I enabled it, those files, the configurations got pulled into the active store, and then drush migrate status basically, you know, asked Drupal, the configuration system, hey, do you have any migrations configured? Look, we have one. It's called DE6 audio. And it actually, as part of the migrate status, it actually queries my source database. So it just queried my Drupal EZ6 site and said, oh, there's 172 nodes of type audio over there. So we get that.
Where did you store the database credentials?
Settings.php. Here, I will actually show that to you real quick. Cat, nano, sites, default settings. So here is my Drupal 8 database. Here is my legacy Drupal 6 database.
You specified legacy.
Well, by specifying legacy here, it's a really good question. I appreciate you asking me that because, don't say whatever I did.
Got it.
Legacy there. Okay, that's how they match up. Again, all of this, it's on the blog post and it's in GitHub, so you can get all of this. All right, so now we can do a drush migrate import DE6 audio. If we wanted to, normally when I'm developing, yeah, I don't want to do them all. I might do 10 just to try. So you do limit 10, it'll just migrate 10 of them in. You can look at them, see if they work. If they don't, roll them back, tweak, remigrate. That's kind of the game. Pretty confident these are going to work. Created, no failed, none ignored. We do our migrate status again. All of them imported, none unprocessed. We come to our site. We got all kinds of audio there. If we click to edit, we see we've got a title, we've got our markdown in there. The text format is set to markdown. The audio URL came through just as it should. The author is set to user one. Our author information came through, so we don't lose any of those valuable dates. And we're good to go. And the migration's done. If, for some reason, oh, you can clap, I'll suck it in. Help me sleep tonight. If you don't like it, roll it back. It's migrate-rollback-mr. Oh. How about I tell it which one I want to roll back? DE6 audio. I'm going to show you one other thing because this is going to be a gotcha as well. It kind of goes along with that first gotcha. All right, so we'll roll back. So we can do another migrate status. We can see now there's none imported. And if I reload my content page, they're gone. So now, in my younger days, you know, a year ago, I would say, oh, well, I have to tweak my migration, so I'll just uninstall and reinstall, and that will suck my migration back into the active store. You will, if I wasn't going to show you this, you would try this. But now that I'm showing you this, you have this burden free. You do a drush pm uninstall DE6 migrate. So you're thinking, okay, well, I'm going to uninstall and reinstall. That will suck my configuration back in. But unfortunately, what I'm doing this, it doesn't actually remove the active configuration. That blows. Let's face it, that just sucks. So we can prove that a couple of ways. Number one, we can do a Drush MS and be like, what the hell? I thought I had installed that. Why is that still showing me a migration that should be uninstalled? Well, because the configuration is still in active store. That blows. So if you really want to go through this of uninstalling and reinstalling, after you uninstall, you've got to do a Drush config delete. And then it's going to be migrate plus, this is the name of the migration. Migration dot, I think it's, I always forget the names of these things. Migration DE6 audio. So you have to manually delete the configuration from active store. Migration group, you got to do the group as well. Because if you don't do both of them and you try and reinstall, you get an error saying, no, there's already configuration for this, you can't enable the module. Migration group DE6, is that right? DE6. So now at this point, now we can tweak that file if we wanted to, save it, and then do a, let's do, let me clear it just so we can get up top. Clear. So now if I did a Drush MS, it's going to be gone. Oh, it's still there. Wow, you know where that? I don't know why. Okay, so now I gotta look. What time is it? Wow, we're way over. You guys are the best.
And nobody left.
Nobody left. Well, there's one guy, so I'm gonna find him later. Okay, I gotta see. Look, I said clear. I gotta rebuild caches. It's gone. It's really gone this time.
You did this.
Yeah. So now you can do Drush enable slash YDE6 audio. Now the migration from the file, we're gonna up D6 migrate. That's what happened in a rush. Now the migration, the configuration from the file is gonna get sucked in because there's nothing blocking it from getting sucked in. So don't do it this way, because this way is a pain in the ass because you got, sorry, this, I'm in the community working group, so I apologize for swearing. this way, you know, you've got three or four extra Drush commands. Just use Drush config edit. It looks like this, Drush and last thing, and then we're out here. migrate plus dot migration group dot DE6. It just pulls up, you know, it looks like it has some extra stuff in there, but that's our, you know, that's basically it. It pulls this up in here. Now we can make changes in here, and when we exit, it will actually tell you there's no changes to import. If there was a change, it would re-import into active. When you do this, make sure you still update your file. Because you got to update both at that point, which kind of sucks. Okay, thank you very much. If you have questions, I'll hang out as long as you need to. GitHub, DrupalEase.com for the blog post. See you tonight, hopefully. Bye-bye.